2021 was a pretty decent year for me, honestly. I graduated high school, went to too many games, collected a lot of vinyl, went to my first concert, and did a good amount of gaming as usual. Although I didn't play a lot of games from this year aside from a few, a shout out to Bowser's Fury. But I did listen to plenty of new albums. Were they all great? Not really. There was a lot of stuff that just washed over me or just simply didn't click with me. And yeah, there were some stinkers too. I'd say the absolute worst album I heard this year was definitely that new Offspring. They're all pushing 60, and it sounds like it. But when that Pale Waves album that dropped was terrible. Some of the worst and most vapid pop rock I've ever heard. Along with those, there were also a handful of disappointments throughout the year. Hayley Williams came through with an incredibly boring indie folk album. Idols released what's probably their weakest album. And then we have Kanye. What happened? Yeah, Donda's painfully flawed, and I could rant about it for quite a while, but hey, we're not here to complain about the bad stuff. We're here to talk about the best of the best, the cream of the crop from 2021, so let's get into it. But before we get into the top 5, I want to talk about some honorable mentions slash runner-ups. First, I want to shout out Baby Keem with the Melodic Blue. Sure, this thing is far from perfect. A good amount of it is bland trap rap, but when Keem comes through with a creative beat and animated flow, it's just a ton of fun. I come back to tracks like Range Brothers, Family Ties, and Coco a good bit. Weezer's OK Human was not something I enjoyed at first, but once I gave it a few listens, it's very solid. I don't love it, but I like how they still made these tracks groove like rock songs even with the baroque instrumentation. The production is immaculate and the hooks pop a lot of the time, despite some cringy boomer lyrics here and there. Alright, here's a neat one, Catbite with Nice One. This album is just a lean collection of ska punk tracks with good energy, catchy hooks, and raw production. Ska music is a ton of fun, and it's cool seeing bands like Catbite bring the genre back, and doing it well at that. It's no masterpiece or anything, but it's definitely worth a shot. The Killers come through with something a bit different on Pressure Machine, and I loved it a lot. Here the band trades out all the anthemic pop rock for some heartland rock. I'm not familiar with the genre at all really, but I dug what the Killers did here. I really love the small town narrative the band went with. The writing on songs like Quiet Town really paint a picture in my head. And despite the change in style, you still get plenty of soaring Killers choruses that we all know and love. So yeah, Pressure Machine is yet another win in the band's catalog. Next, I have to shout out Jeff Rosenstock's Ska Dream. The man took his album from last year and gave it a complete ska makeover. It's so much fun. Jeff even made sure to work in different shades of the genre from ska punk to more two-tone stuff. It was such a great surprise this year and I had a ton of fun listening to it. But Jeff has a lot of love for ska, and I'm glad he could let that shine. Here's hoping he puts out a fully original ska album in the future. And finally, we have Magdalena Bay with Mercurial World. Now, if you like indie pop, synth pop, or dance pop, this is a must listen. Instantly lovable hooks and some incredible grooves. I heard a couple of the singles beforehand, and I actually wasn't too crazy about the vocals, but after seeing how many people were praising the album, I decided to give it a chance, and I'm very glad I did. It's such a good, dancey synth-pop album that incorporates a variety of different styles really well. This record is so incredibly infectious, and I really debated putting this in my number 5 spot, but I ended up giving a very slight edge to something else. Who let the dope boys out? Brockhampton, a group that I wasn't very familiar with before I heard this album. I mean, I heard a couple tracks here and there, but the singles from this album intrigued me, so I gave it a shot. And man, when I first heard this thing, I was really impressed, especially since I wasn't too familiar with much modern hip-hop at the time. It also got me really into Brockhampton as a whole, and other alternative hip-hop artists. Overall, Roadrunner, along with Saturation 3, influenced my taste quite a bit, which is why I ended up placing it over Mercurial World. The group go back to a lot of those energetic vibes from the Saturation trilogy and update them. Songs like Buzzcut, Bankroll, and Don't Shoot Up the Party showcase this well, with Buzzcut being one of my top favorites from the album. I love Kevin's opening verse, Danny Brown is insane, and that outro is blissful. So much of Roadrunner is pretty addictive too. Like when this came out, I was listening to I'll Take You On constantly. And while I've definitely overplayed it for myself, I still adore the vocal harmonies throughout the track. It's super catchy. But on the opposite side of the spectrum, we get a song like Windows. It's 6 minutes long and is a massive gut punch, especially during Joba's verse. Plus, that auto-tuned chorus that pops up later in the track is just so good. Oh, and can I just point out how beautiful Dear Lord is? It's mostly a cappella, but I'm such a sucker for Bareface's voice. It's a great performance from him. Roadrunner is just an incredibly solid hip-hop album in my opinion. It's not perfect by any means, but there are certainly some songs that shrunk on me a little, but it's still a great project that I'm glad I listened to. So, I've been familiar with Bruno Mars' hits for years, and I've never heard an Anderson .Paak album, but I saw a lot of people hyping up the Silk Sonic collaboration and decided to check it out. I did like some of the singles, but the full album is what impressed me. Now, I'm super unfamiliar with a lot of the 70s funk and soul that Silk Sonic pulls from, but that didn't stop me from loving this album. Bruno and Anderson come through with a lean tracklist of smooth, blissful, and ridiculously catchy funk songs. Like seriously, I'm pretty sure these guys laced crack into this album. I think what I love most about this project is how each song feels so complete. Like when a song ends, it ends with a bang. Silk Sonic always finds a way to build up a song to the max, making everything feel grand as if they were putting on a show. But through this, they never forget to weave in some undeniable choruses, with Leave the Door Open and After Last Night being the best examples of this in my opinion. Bruno and Anderson just make a great pair here, always giving impassioned performances with a lot of swagger. This album just oozes charisma, more charisma than I could ever dream of having, frankly, and I'm very glad I checked it out. A definite highlight for the year. Boy, it sure was nice of Tyler the Creator to drop an album right as I was getting into his music. But jokes aside, I was very excited for this album and listened to it the second it dropped. Call Me Figa Lost is a much different project compared to Igor, but it didn't need to be, nor was I expecting it to. Here Tyler returns to more hard-hitting rap songs that come off as sort of an improved version of his older material, in a way. Tracks like Corso, Lumberjack, and Juggernaut showcase cold-blooded flows from Tyler backed up by some bass-heavy beats that are a lot of fun to listen to. But this album is far from one note. On Massa, Tyler can be heard talking about how he's matured and grown as an artist over some raw drums. Then Wilshire is a 7-minute suite that might have a pretty whack beat, but it tells one hell of a story. Tyler also works in some melodic moments like What's Your Name, which is an infectious track. I love Tyler's verse, I love the soul sample, and Youngboy's verse is incredible. It's one of my favorite songs on the album. But I can't mention the melodic tracks without bringing up Sweet/I Thought You Wanted to Dance. It's an excellent two-parter. The first half sounds like an Igor B-side with some sugary lyrics, but the second half is this mellow, beautiful reggae song that goes over so freaking well. The fact that Tyler was able to pull off an instrumental like this amazes me. In fact, the production on this album is just straight excellence. Each and every beat is so creative and unique to Tyler. I'm glad he doesn't feel the need to water down his sound with generic trap beats despite being really mainstream. Like, Run It Up does have those hi-hats, but it's the only song that does that. But it's a great track regardless. I love the loud horns on Lemonhead, the distant vocal samples on Manifesto, the griminess of Lumberjack, and the razor-sharp snares on Juggernaut are super cool. This album might not have as upfront of a concept as Igor or Flower Boy, aside from this light traveling theme, but what it lacks in narrative is made up for with a ton of energy. Pretty much everything on Call Me Figa Lost is on point, and while it's not Tyler's best, it's still one hell of an accomplishment. So I found out about this band because Fantano happened to shout out their song Blackout during one of his weekly track roundups. I checked it out and was hooked. Then I listened to a few more of their other songs and I was even more hooked. I didn't listen to every teaser track they had out as to not spoil the album, but I was very excited for Glow On. To be honest, I was a little worried that it wouldn't live up to my expectations. I was wrong. This album kicks ass. In fact, it's one of the best punk records I've ever heard. It's that freaking good. Turnstile's last two albums were packed with plenty of hardcore punk goodness, but Glow On far surpasses their past work by a mile. Here the band takes that classic hardcore sound and does so much new stuff with it. One big issue I have with some punk adjacent albums is that a lot of the songs can end up blending together, like that new Descendants record for example. But Glow On does not do that one bit. For one, the band sorta sweetened up their sound with some reverb and more melodic vocals, but this album still rips. The riffs smash, the drums pound, and the choruses are super explosive. There's a reason everyone goes completely nuts during their live shows. The production is nice and clean, but no expense was spared to still make everything hit like a brick. Turnstile always finds a way to spice up each song, which keeps this album feeling fresh and visceral. This, in my opinion, is what makes Glow On so amazing. The band aren't afraid to take influence from other genres or use instruments that you wouldn't normally associate with punk music, like drum machines or a synthesizer. Blackout, Holiday, and Underwater Boy make good use of a drum machine, and I love the way Mystery opens up with those swirling synth notes. Stuff like this gives songs a lot of flavor and makes things more interesting. But if that wasn't enough, Don't Play's chorus has an honest-to-God Latin groove during the chorus. Alien Love Call is a full-on dream gaze song that might be slow-paced, but it fits the album oddly well. In fact, songs like Underwater Boy and Lonely Desires also have a pretty dreamy feel, but still keep with the energy. The latter of the two even features a section where the song gets taken over by some ethereal synths. Like, you just don't hear all this stuff on other punk albums, but here's Turnstile doing something really damn cool and unique. And it's not like they're doing these things in some tacky way. No, they do it with care, and it's awesome. Like, they probably could have done a full-on trap break during one of the songs, and I probably would have liked it. I mean, for God's sakes, New Heart Design has these super slick, clean 80s guitars, but despite that, the chorus is super hard-hitting. And if that isn't proof of this album's greatness, I don't know what is. But speaking of choruses, all of them are great. Brendan Yates comes through with a lot of shouted, yet melodic vocals that sound huge. His voice just elevates the intensity of these songs and makes them incredibly addictive. So yeah, if it wasn't obvious, I adore this album, and I had a blast every time I came back to it. It's a near-perfect punk masterpiece. But we have one more album to talk about. Yep, this is the one. While I loved it a lot at first listen, it grew on me even more as the year went by. Nurture is a perfect album, plain and simple. This was also my introduction to Porter's music, and while I like Worlds, this is leaps and bounds better. Nurture still has a lot of those EDM aesthetics, no doubt, but Porter created something unique here by melding those loud synths and kick drums with acoustic instrumentation, creating this wonderful blend of organic and synthetic, which is aided by a lot of the floral visuals present on both the album cover and promotional material. There's so many amazing moments on Nurture that I can look back on. The way the synths bust in on Look at the Sky, the emotional vocal break at the end of Wind Tempos, the way the acoustic guitar weaves into these indie-tronic beats on the Do Re Mi, the ridiculously catchy Cara Cara Bonito sample on Musician, the drop on Something Comforting, it's just incredible. In fact, I'd say that pretty much all the drops and payoffs on this album are absolutely fantastic. With Something Comforting, the way it builds up and just hits you over the head with synths, it gives me chills almost every time. Oh, and the way Look at the Sky's chorus comes back after the bridge is just pure bliss. The drops on Musician and Mirror are excellent as well, the latter of which having a really cool and unique synth tone. I also want to talk more about the way Porter blends acoustic instruments into this album, since it's a really neat attribute that gives Nurture a very human feel. I already mentioned the way Do Re Mi does this, but a lot of other songs have really sweet touches of piano that sound amazing. Porter even goes full circle with the track Blossom, which is a straight up acoustic ballad. Normally, I really, really don't like these kinds of songs, but he wrote it for his girlfriend, it's really heartfelt, and it fits well in the tracklist. This album is euphoric to me, honestly, and I love it for that. Look at the uplifting lyrics to Look at the Sky, or the sweet sentiments of Mother. Hell, the synth tones alone sound joyful. Now, I like edgy music as much as the next guy, but it's nice to have an album like this that's uplifting but not childish. I don't feel like I'm listening to something that's engineered to make me feel good. I feel like I'm listening to something with genuine emotion. In interviews, Porter talked a lot about how he was in a creative rut for a while. But he eventually bounced back, and I can really tell that he poured his heart and soul into this music because it sounds like it. Even a song like Wind Tempos, which is mostly subtly glitchy piano chords, still radiates a lot of emotion. Then once you get to those vocal samples, it's oddly moving. It's funny, when I first heard them, I had no clue what the lyrics were, but it still hit me in the feels. Nurture just has this way of enlivening me every time I listen to it. In my Persona 4 video, I mentioned how that game was a stress reliever for me, and Nurture is honestly the same way. I listen to it, and I feel a little better, and I think that's incredible. I even got to see him live this year, and for a first concert, I couldn't have asked for anything better. Porter really knew how to put on a show, and I loved hearing all of these incredible tracks live. Nurture currently stands as one of my favorite electronic albums, right up there with Daft Punk's Discovery and Burial's Untrue. Blissful, life-affirming, uplifting, and euphoric are all words I'd use it to describe Nurture. It really is something comforting.